Well, now we're going to talk about an issue that you already may be well aware of, and that's toxic workplaces. They are on the rise as many workplaces are embracing unhealthy values. Our career expert Kym McNicholas joins us this morning with the author of Toxic Workplace to explain why this is happening and what you can do about it as both an employee and an employer. Kym?
Good morning, Marty. Well, almost all of us have worked with someone with a toxic personality. It's someone who we would likely see as a bully. They humiliate others, use sarcastic remarks, and they do a lot of things that just make you feel uncomfortable. They take pot shots at people, they meddle in everyone else's business, and yet they still have a job. Well, Dr. Mitchell Kusy is the author of Toxic Workplace, also a corporate psychologist and professor at Antioch University. How in the world do these people still have a job?
Kym, that's the age-old question. In the research that Dr. Elizabeth Holloway and I had done on 400 people, we found that there are some amazing statistics as to why do people get away with bad behavior.
Right.
So how do they have a job? Well, first of all, many of these individuals are some of the highest producers in your organization.
Very productive.
You go try to fire a high producer. There are some answers to this, but we'll save that for a little bit later. So that first is they're high producers. Secondly, there's often what we found a toxic protector. This is the individual who is aware of their productivity and or maybe have a special relationship with them and allows them to get away with bad behavior.
Wow, that makes it even more difficult. So in terms of your research, what was the most surprising thing that came out of it?
There were a few, Kym. First of all, 94% of us work with a toxic individual. That was the first piece of the research. It is really a lot. You know, I can't go to a cocktail party when someone finds
someone
out what they do,
and then
they monopolize. And I understand where they're coming from. So that's the first piece. The second is many of them are clueless about the effects of their behaviors on others. And that's one of the reasons, third surprising statistic, that feedback often fails. You try to give someone feedback about their toxic behavior when they're clueless of the effects of that behavior on others.
And something that caught my eye with your book and a presentation that I attended recently at the Battery was the impact on our healthcare, bullying in the workplace, in a doctor's office, and how it could lead to us getting the wrong medication.
Oh, interestingly, that's one of the primary statistics from many researchers out there, that they found in general that 60 to 80% of the medication errors are due to a disruptive individual. Let me tell you a story. We were doing a keynote address, and someone raised his hand and said, you know what, my wife is a nurse, and just last night she said that she couldn't read the medication order. So subsequently, rather than go to the disruptive physician or the head nurse, she ended up going to three or four other individuals to interpret the medication order.
Wow. That's crazy. So when you go to a doctor's office, make sure that everybody's getting along, right?
You know, when I'm a patient, I go to a doctor's office, the very first thing I look for is in that central office, are people getting along? Mm-hmm. Are people rolling their eyes when someone speaks? When the physician or head nurse comes in, is there respectful engagement? You know, we've coined the term everyday civility. So it's respectful engagement every day.
So if you are in a workplace and you have a colleague that seems to be toxic, how do you deal with them?
Well, there's a number of things. First of all, one of the primary things that we recommend is don't go it alone. Think
power
ahead.
Power in numbers.
Power in numbers. You know, if the person is a toxic individual, is a boss, I can tell you the boss is not going to fire three or four individuals. So first of all, do some surfacing of the problem, seeing if other individuals are having a problem. Talk about it. Don't gossip, but talk about it proactively. And then go to this individual to talk with him or her about their behavior. And if you're frightened to do that, even in numbers, find someone else whom this individual has respect for and go in with this individual.
And what if you're a leader? How do you deal with a toxic person? Because you have a lot of people that I would imagine would quit before even wanting to address it with you.
Well, absolutely. One of the interesting things that we found in our research is many of these toxic individuals are chameleons. They're very capable of kissing up and kicking down. And so if you go to a leader, often he or she may say, you know what, this individual seems a little bit tough on people, but you know what? Basically, he or she is a great person.
So I can't imagine that they would say something
or do something like that. So subsequently, power in numbers. Also, have your system in place. If you have a performance appraisal process or performance management system, this is for all leaders out there. Be sure that the values are integrated in the performance management process. When we've asked people this question, what we discovered is only 5 to 10% of individuals, organizations have the values spelled out on the performance management system and where people get feedback based on the values.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mitchell Kusy. One of my favorite parts of his book is when he says that if you're going to hire someone, make sure you engage your old team, the people in the cafeteria, your assistants and all that jazz, and see how they treat them when they walk into your office. Marty, back to you.
Great tips. Thank you, Kym, and thank you, Mitchell, and we'll be right back.